38. Okay, I'm going to call to order the Wednesday, August 19th Board of Directors meeting for the Denver Regional Council of Governments. We're going to start with our Pledge of Allegiance. If we'd all please rise. Okay, roll call.
Eva Henry.
Here.
Bill Holland.
Here.
Elise Jones.
Here.
Dennis Harward.
Here.
Tim Mock. Tom Hayden. Christy Panganello.
Here.
Robin Knieche.
Here with my alternate present, Kevin Flynn, new to the room. Thank you.
Okay.
I'm introducing him in a minute.
Sorry.
Yeah. Roger Partridge.
Here.
Gail Watson.
Here.
Don Rozier.
Here.
Bob Pfeiffer.
Here.
Bob Roth.
Here.
Sue Horn. Larry Vittem. David Spellman. Suzanne Jones.
Here.
Ann Justin. Rick Pilgrim. Lynn Baca.
Here.
George Teal.
Here.
Kathy Noon.
Here.
Ron Engels. Catherine Hyder. Laura Chrisman, Alex Brown, Gail Christie,
here.
Jim Benson,
here.
Debbie Nasta, Joe Baker, Todd Riddle, Laura Keegan, Joe Jefferson,
here.
Dan Woog, Mark Gruber, Joyce Thomas, Daniel Dick, George Heath, Samantha Meering, Lisa Jones, Laura Brown, Henry Ergot, Lynette Kelsey, Paula Bobo, Doris Ragoni, Saoirse Karras Graves, Marjorie Sloan, Ron Rakowski.
Here.
Mike Hillman, Brad Weasley.
Here.
Shakti.
Here.
Jerry Bean, Phil Cernanek.
Present.
Jackie Millay.
Here.
Gabe Santos.
Here.
Ashley Stolzman.
Here.
John O'Brien.
Here.
Colleen Whitlow.
Here.
Deborah Jerome. Sean Forey. Chris Larson, Joe Gerlach, Joyce Downing,
here.
John Dyack,
here.
Gary Howard,
here.
Rita Dozel,
here.
Val Vigil,
here.
Herb Atchison, Anita Seitz, Joyce Jay, Bud Starker, Gary Sanford,
here.
Deborah Perkins-Smith,
here.
Bill Van Meter,
here.
We do have a quorum.
Okay, we have a board member who is here for the first time. I want to make a special point of introducing Gail Watson from Gilpin County. Don't scare her off, folks. So, Gail, raise your hand and wave just so they know where you are. Right there. Thank you. And I want to introduce our new alternates that are joining us this evening. And Kevin Flynn is here. Kevin, welcome. And, Kevin, now I'm going to be very unfriendly. Would you... The rule is, we do follow some rules here down at DRCOG, that alternates sit in the audience when their board member is present. And for MVIC, actually, you sit there, but for this process, so I apologize. But the alternates are asked to sit in the audience. And then also Steve Yates from Englewood, the new alternate. Is Steve here somewhere?
No.
Nope, he is not here, but if he was here, he'd have to sit in the audience. Oh, and Gary Sanford, it's your first meeting. Gary, where are you? Oh, there you are, Gary. Good to see you. Welcome. Okay, the fun is over. We are moving on to, I'd like to entertain a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained. We have an agenda. We're going to start off with the report of the chair. The Regional Transportation Committee did not meet, so there is nothing to report on there. And I am going to turn it over to Jerry Stiegel, who is going to report on structure and governance, but I do want to give a special plug on August 31st, which is a Monday. The Iraqi youth delegation is going to be here in the morning from, Connie, help me.
9 to 1,
and it's a great lunch. So if you have time and can even come for a portion of that to meet with some of the kids who have been here from Iraq for the summer and talk about their experience, and I participated in 3, not with youth, but with other delegations, and it's a really worthwhile experience. You will come away with a real great appreciation and feel very blessed to be living in this wonderful country that we get to live in. All right, Jerry, structure and governance. And Jerry promises me it'll be brief.
What questions do you have?
No, not that
brief. Oh, sorry. That's my standard line. You know that. Okay. I'm going to go back 2 meetings quickly. So if we go back to meetings 7 and 8, 8 being the most recent, 7 being in July, we had August 5, I think, was – yeah, August 5 was our meeting 8. We discussed in meeting 7 the –
excuse me, Jerry, for the benefit of people who may not be aware, can you just give a little brief summary of what the structure and governance group is?
Yeah, I'm sorry. Sure. Structure and governance was a committee or subgroup that was designed to really look at some components, structural things, dues, voting, all the things that would go into making this function more, you know, seamlessly, we'll say. And so we've entertained a number of topics. We brought in, through sort of this volunteer process, we put together these groups, and we've continued to work on these issues to bring back to the board for you to decide, look at, vote on, etc. So this is a group of about, around 16 people that spend extra time to work through some of the mechanical things that I think will improve how we work together. Anything?
That's good. Okay. And new members are welcome to join. It's not a closed group.
Exactly. Okay, thank you. So meeting 7, we actually talked about MVIC, Metro Vision Issues Committee, proposing it as a potential work session, opening it up for everyone. So that discussion is still ongoing. We brought that into meeting 8 as well, and we worked on it some, but we added another topic, which was the dual voting system. So in meeting 8, we were able to test our current turning point system that you use. If you go to the board workshop, Doctor of Cognology, the clickers and all that, it works for dual voting. You take 2 votes, 1 regular, 1 weighted. So that seemed to work well. We'll continue to test it. Dues we talked a little bit about in the last session, and we'll bring that back with some information that our committee asked us to provide in terms of looking out at how the dues, where the dues are today, because of course the timing is key due to the upcoming budget approval. So we'll continue the work session discussion, likely get to the dues, and the one thing that staff is going to bring back in general so we can kind of keep on track is a topic list with some estimated timelines. I will stop there, and anyone that's in the committee that I missed anything or if you'd like to add?
Okay, seeing none, thank you, Jerry.
You're welcome.
And now we're going to move on to the report of the executive director, Jennifer.
Thank you. Just a few things. It's a lot of information on aging this evening. The first thing I wanted to talk about was to encourage you to consider becoming part of the Aging Advisory Committee. The Area Agency on Aging here, DRCOG, is one of 2 federally designated programs, and like the MPO, the AAA has several state and federal requirements that it has to follow. And it would be good for as many board members as possible to understand what those things are. The AAA funds a lot of local community service providers in the region, and committee members actually help decide how those funds are going to be invested throughout the region for to meet the needs of older adults. Excuse me, the committee is comprised of all of the counties, county councils on aging, a number of community experts, as well as DRCOG board members, and the ACA rules say that up to 5 DRCOG board members can be on the ACA, and currently we only have 2. Phil Cernanek is on the committee representing the board, and Kathy Noon is on the committee, but Kathy, in her capacity on the ACA, represents Arapahoe County. So it would be great. John O'Brien, from Lyons, also represents the DRCOG board. So we have 3 vacancies for board members, and it would be great if there's some of you out there that have interest in this. In the coming months, the committee is going to be discussing the results of a number of community assessments that we've done around the region, as well as dealing with legislative matters like, in Washington, the reauthorization of the Older Americans Act. Your board input is really critical to understanding what it is that we need to do out in the community, and also to advise on different issues that are coming up at the AAA in the future. We're expecting, in fact, we've actually had private companies come to us and ask the AAA to help out with some work that they've done in the past. So we're really, it would be really great for any of you who have interest in aging issues. Remember, 1 in 4 of us are going to be over 60 in the next 20 years. That's a full quarter of the regional population. This has huge impacts on how we grow and develop and creating a built environment as well as providing services to attend this population. So it's very, very important. The group meets once a month. They generally have about 10 meetings a month. They meet on the third Friday of the month from 12 to 3 here in this room, and lunch is provided. So think this Friday, yes, there's a meeting this Friday. So if you have interest, please let me know, or grab Jayla, or even drop an email to Connie. But let us know if you have interest in serving on the advisory committee for aging.
Jennifer, could I add just a quick comment on that? In addition to being fed, a particular area of interest is as funding for a lot of services, including senior services, from governmental sources is diminishing. One of the items that we're continuing to look at with Jayla's lead on this is other items, and as Jennifer mentioned, being approached by private organizations for the competencies that we do have available through the AAA organization itself, making those available so that there's a possible revenue source on that. So folks that might have some particular business acumen on fee for services or revenue for services would be appreciated.
Okay. Wanted to let you know, too, that on August 15th, Dr. Cog hosted a formal presentation of something called the United States of Aging Survey 2015. Denver results were provided for a large group that was over across the street at the new boutique art hotel. There was also, in addition to releasing these survey results about aging in Denver, in the Denver metro region, the governor's office announced the governor's appointees to the newly created strategic planning group on aging. The purpose of the event was to provide information on this big survey that had occurred, and to pull people together to talk about how do we deal with the challenges that the survey found. Jayla, I didn't even ask. How many people did we have there? Do we know? About just ballpark. That's what I was thinking, about 120 folks from all kinds of different areas of whether it was government, it could be family members, it could be businesses. There were people on policy, there were state and federal representatives there, but all very interested in how do we as a region go forward dealing with the aging population. We got great press on this event. 7 News did a story. There were interviews with Colorado Public Radio. We even got a mention in Forbes.com in an article about why more cities aren't planning for an aging population. And there was also good coverage from the Denver Post. So if you're interested in seeing those results, there's a nice there's a slide presentation as well as an actual kind of booklet on all those survey results. But we'll be taking that information and continuing to work with this with these folks that came together and again try to figure out how do we deal with some of the issues of a rapidly aging population. There is something in the works here, Dr. Cog, you should all put on your calendars. We're planning an Older Americans Act Summit. We'll be bringing together, hopefully, the governor. His staff are very interested in this, as well as the Colorado Congressional Delegation, state senators and representatives, and those folks that are out there providing services to seniors. This would be to do a policy summit, and this is on Thursday, October 15th, from 8 to 10:30 here at Dr. Cog. And the intent of the event is to highlight the Dr. Cog advocacy for seniors related to the Older Americans Act reauthorization. I'm sure most of you, if not all of you, I know that there's a couple of new people in the room, but you've heard me talk about the many trips that we've made to Washington to talk to the delegation about reauthorization. The event will include some presentations on Dr. Cog's advocacy, Dr. Cog's senior care provider advocacy, state and elected official advocacy, and how working together we can strengthen both federal and state programs for seniors. Actually, on the state side, we've done very well. For the last 3 years in a row, Dr. Cog and its partners have worked successfully at the state capitol and brought $12 million over the last 3 years into the program for aging services for the state. So we've done really well on that side of things. We've had success, but not enough success in D.C. at this point. But we'll be sending out a formal invitation to members really shortly. And let's see, what else do I need to tell you about? Just as a kind of an FYI, we met with the Washington director and the legislative assistant in Representative Kaufman's office this week. They're in town. The Congress is on break, and so they're trying to get a little bit better acquainted with the district. We discussed transportation projects within the district. We discussed the funding shortfall within the district and within the region and within the nation. We also talked about the Older Americans Act and the challenges that we're seeing there. The Senate has passed a bill. It'll be going into the House now and trying to figure out what the House is going to do and making sure that members of the House understand our concerns with the bill that the Senate passed. And we alerted them that we'll be back in D.C. in September to talk some more about these issues. And just a couple more things. I'll be meeting with staff and the city and county managers, as well as those senior planner types in counties that don't have a county manager, to talk about the urban growth boundary next week. This is part of my effort to broaden our partnerships and improve relationships, but also make sure that we understand from our member jurisdictions' point of view what challenges they see and have had with urban growth boundary. So this is the first of several meetings that I anticipate we'll have over the coming months on big, important emerging issues that we want the managers to know about. And then finally, just one more aging thing. As I mentioned a moment ago, the governor appointed members to the Strategic Planning Group on Aging. This is a bill, this came out of House Bill 151033. He appointed 23 individuals to this group, and I was one of those that he appointed. The purpose of the group is to look at the challenges that we're having with the aging population throughout the state and to actually provide a report to the governor and the legislature in November of 2016 on what things we might do as a state to make the entire state more more senior friendly. So I'll keep you up to date on that as the group meets. We've only met once, and that was really just to talk about how we organize ourselves and how we'll go forward with this big initiative that we've been tasked with.
Thank you, Jennifer. We are moving on to
Jackie.
Yes. You? Yes, Bob. Bob Roth actually has a I forgot, Bob. I was going to have you speak during other matters. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I just wanted to point out that one of my day job responsibilities is that I sit on the board of Associated General Contractors of Colorado, and we asked Jennifer to come to our meeting last Wednesday. There was an interest with the Specialty Contractors Council to understand more about DRCOG, its function, what we do, how we're structured, things like that. So last Wednesday, Jennifer came and represented DRCOG at the Specialty Contractors Council, 35 people probably there representing various contractors throughout the region. And I think the time allotted, the time slot was about 40 minutes or something, and it went probably about an hour and a half, because there was that level of interest and questions about what we do down here. So I just wanted to briefly mention that thank you to Jennifer for taking time to do that, and it was very well received, and I think the contracting community has a much better idea of what we do down here now.
Thank you, Bob. Now we are moving on to agenda number 7, public comment. Up to 45 minutes is allocated at this time for public comment, and each speaker will be limited to 3 minutes. If there are additional requests from the public to address the board, time will be allocated at the end of the meeting to complete public comment. I request that there be no public comment on issues for which a prior public hearing has been held before the board. Consent and action items will begin immediately after the last speaker. Anyone here for public comment? Okay, we're going to move on then to the consent agenda. Agenda item number 8, I'll look for a motion. Second? All those in favor? Aye. opposed and abstained. Okay, action agenda number 9, discussion and direction to staff on the draft planned activities and associated costs. It's attachment B in your packet. I'll turn it back to our executive director.
Okay. Thank you, Madam Chair. As Jackie said, this is item 9, attachment B in your package. And it's for discussion and direction to staff concerning any modifications and or additional information to support preparation of the 2016 annual budget and associated activities. This item is a follow-up to your action in July to adopt an annual budget and a work program together annually in November to start the 2016 process this month to ensure time for you to weigh in on both, and starting in 2016 to host the board's annual workshop in the fall of each year to better inform the process. So this is a new process, and several members are new to both the budget and the work plan, so this exercise has been divided into some manageable pieces. So tonight we're going to review the draft planned activities and associated expenditures. In September, we'll review the potential new and enhanced activities and revenue sources. In October, the draft goes to the administrative committee to recommend the budget to the board, and then in November, the board would adopt the budget as established by the Articles of Association. Just for background, a number of you will recall that in late 2013, I explained at the board's request my plans for sharpening the board's organizational strategy. That included aligning our activities with the budget, measuring performance, and researching peer best practices for the purpose of refining existing and initiating new programs and revenue streams. The action that you took last month, adopting the list of staff activities with the budget in November, hosting the workshop in advance of that adoption, that gets us much closer to assuring that the organization's efforts support DRCOG's mission and vision, and the activities all fit nicely within the budget. There's still a little bit of work to be done in that area, but this is major progress on that initiative. Related to developing activities and the budget, to address measuring performance, we're developing a balanced scorecard. Some of you, I'm sure, have heard Jerry talk about this. For about a year now, we've been working with Jerry Stiegel, our Director of Organizational Development, to develop this scorecard. It's not fast and it's not easy, but it's critical to that alignment of DRCOG's activities to the board's vision, as well as measuring our performance here at DRCOG. I decided I should look into this a little bit more after Jerry told me that this is what he wanted to do, this ballot scorecard work, and I'm just going to name a few, but some of the best and brightest organizations actually use ballot scorecard. The Walt Disney Corporation, Wells Fargo, the University of Denver, UPS, the National Marrow Donor Program, and our good friends down in Douglas County have used ballot scorecard. So staff is developing the ballot scorecard using the strategic planning management framework. That's that, basically that blank form that's right behind this this memo in your package. We estimate we still have another 4 to 5 months before we can complete that. I also want to note here that there's one important change in terminology. Here at DRCOG, in the parlance of balanced scorecard, the term work program, which is what we've always called this list in the past, is replaced with strategic initiatives. In balanced scorecard, strategic initiatives are those projects and programs and activities that are critical to advancing the board's mission and vision. This is just a change in terminology. This isn't a change in anything but terminology, but it's really necessary to eliminate confusion here internally as we develop the scorecard and migrate to the balanced scorecard vernacular. Finally, with regard to sharpening the organization structure, strategy, I'm not going to dwell tonight on peer reviews and best practices and what we're doing to increase revenues, since that's going to be in part the focus of your September meeting. But I do want to say that we've been, as I mentioned a moment ago, we've been approached by others, hospitals in particular, who are interested in contracting with the AAA. We've been researching the work of our peers around the nation, and we've been researching the needs of our member jurisdictions, and we have a lot of ideas for improving service delivery, sharing resources, lowering the cost at DRCOG, and upgrading our technology tools. So let's get to that list of strategic initiatives. That is the document behind the blank form right behind this memo. I want to point out that the activities are listed by funding source. In other words, we've broken out where projects are funded. There's the UPWP. There are various grants where money comes from. There's service income, and so on. So that's how that list works. There are some notable differences between 2015 and 2016. Primarily due to grants that are ending and other grants that are starting up. For example, the Community-Based Care Transition Program grant ended. That constituted $262,000 in 2015. Also, as you all know, the Sustainable Communities Initiative, or SCI, ended. In 2015, there was about $273,000 in the budget for that. Another big program that's ending in 2015 is the Commercial Vehicle Survey. This was funded jointly between CDOT and the MPOs through the TIP. There was about $870,000 in the 2015 budget for that project. Those were the things, big things that were ending this year. The things that are starting up now and in 2016, we received a Strategic Highway Research Program, or SHARP 2 grant, of which $260K of a total of $300,000 is budgeted in this year. This is for work around urban centers and supporting member jurisdictions. Also, the Area Agency on Aging received a Veterans Directed Home and Community-Based Service Grant for $146,000 in 2016. This grant provides the opportunity for veterans to come to DRCOG for options counseling, and then the vets are allowed to go out and purchase services from approved vendors of their choice. It's a little bit different than how the AAA works, but it's a great program. We're also ramping back up DRAP, or the Denver Regional Aerial Photography Program. Been around for more than a decade. The program cost is about $860,000 and is funded by our regional partnership, including member governments, other government agencies, and even the private sector. So to wrap up, I'll say that this is a new process, and this is a draft that's in your program tonight. So we're continuing all week we have, and even after this evening, especially after this evening's discussion, we'll continue to refine both the strategic initiatives and the anticipated costs. But tonight's your opportunity to provide input into this process, to ask for clarification on the various initiatives that are listed in the draft. At the July meeting, you approved unanimously the Unified Planning Work Program, or UPWP. So I wouldn't necessarily anticipate a lot of questions on that, but I would anticipate some questions on the other strategic initiatives that are on the list. So in anticipation of those questions, Jerry is here if you have any questions about the ballot scorecard and what that process is and what staff is doing and where we are. Also, the other division directors are here this evening to discuss any questions you may have about the initiatives that they own. And Jenny Dock, our contracts and budget manager, is also here to help respond to questions as well. So with that, I will stop talking and turn it back over to the chair to see what questions you may have.
Any questions? Phil.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Jennifer, on the grant for the Strategic Highway Research Program, just looking for that to be maybe put in some context and go a little bit further. Understand in general it's planning and what it might be. Shailen Bhatt, CDOT director, on his speaking tour has talked about principles that they have within CDOT for their CDOT project selection components. And is this aligned with that? I mean, not that it's a subset of that, but would you see coming out of this some principles that we might use and apply as we consider transportation projects, and that might get into what's the definition of highway in this context? Is it any road, or is it indeed something that's referred to as a highway?
I'm so glad staff are here this evening. So Flo, you want to feel that one?
I'd be delighted to. Let me start by prefacing the origin of the SHARP 2 grant. The funds in SHARP 2 are actually from multiple funding sources at the federal level. They derive from the TRB, Transportation Research Board, the ASHTO, and they also derive from FHWA in USDOT. It's a pooled source of funds, and they have different rounds. We were just granted in round 5. They're currently in round 6, and there will be the final round 7 in the SHARP 2 funding pool. The purpose of this is truly research and development in terms of transportation technologies. And so that spans the gamut, everything from looking at the quality of asphalt or new technologies for laying down asphalt or what goes into the asphalt to transportation planning. And we applied in round 5 because one of the focuses in round 5 was on transportation planning, specifically around best practices in communicating with local governments on transportation project development and on transportation planning in general. The application that we made was specific to how the urban centers that we have would play into that, and also designed to work with a couple of pilot communities to determine how best to communicate, what the questions are, what the framework should be. So that's really what we are working on. A lot of that is including some data analysis on that side of the house, so we are bringing in our travel modeling team and our land use modeling team into the equation as well, along with Brad Calvert's team, who is the project management side of the project. So it does not really, Mayo, have much alignment with CDOT's principles, because this is designed to be a research project.
Thank you.
I have a follow-up question. So you said there were going to be some pilot communities, Flo. So first of all, actually, if you could just introduce yourself, because we do have some new folks here, so not everybody knows you.
I'm sorry, I shouldn't have done that.
Nope, that's fine. And then you did mention pilot communities, so if you could just briefly address how the communities are going to be selected and who might be eligible to be participating, just so the board knows.
Sure. Thanks. I'm Flo Attano, and I have worn many hats here at DRCOG. My most recent hat that I'm wearing is, and why I'm here talking about this, is I'm serving as the Interim Regional Planning and Operations Director, so with Terry Whitmore having left us in April, I stepped into that position, so that's what I'm doing here talking to you this evening. Thank you.
And the pilot communities?
The pilot communities, we have not determined yet how those will be selected. We are contemplating at this point that we might have an application process. There are a number, a limit of communities that we want to work with. We're thinking in the 3 to 5 range is probably the perfect size for the pilot project. Because the topic is urban centers, we will be looking to work with communities that have urban centers, designated urban centers in those. So. Stay tuned. That's part of the work that the team is doing, is determining the selection of the pilot communities.
Great. Thanks. We'll look forward to hearing more. And we have Deborah.
So Deb Perkins-Smith from CDOT. So Flo, I just want to clarify or add to that. So just so there's clarification, CDOT does have a research component, and we have specified funds from FHWA that we have to spend for research. So the point of SHARP too is it's shared among the transportation community, especially the ASHTO members, the state highway transportation officials. So I think nationally we will benefit from this. But to your comment about probably Shailen's principles, he may have been talking about the healthy multimodal system. And certainly I hope the scenario analysis would help enlighten us in some of those areas, what you do in terms of sensitivity or taking a look at that. So I do want to make sure there is that connection there.
and CDOT has been partnering with us on designing the relationship with FHWA and
the contracting.
Yes, right. Thank
you. Thank you, Flo. Suzanne.
So I had a more general question about the, we're not referring to as a work plan, but the plan and the budget, and that is it possible, or at least it would be useful for me to understand which part of this is discretionary and which part of it are things we have to do? Is that possible to kind of weave into this, I don't know, the display of the information, or just to get a sense of that?
Yeah, we can. Some things will be easier to, I think, described than others, but yeah, and when we come back in September, we can mark those things that are required, either from things that the AAA has to do, things that the MPOs are required to do, et cetera. We are happy to bring that back, kind of mark.
Assuming
up
it's not a lot of work, I think that would be useful for us just to be reminded of what we are required to do and what we can choose to do.
Any other? Oh, yes.
Jennifer, you mentioned the strategic planning framework's been an ongoing process.
Mm-hmm.
How far are you, and when can we see a work product? And is the board going to participate in this, or are we just going to kind of take a look at it and approve it?
This is mostly an internal process, and we're actually pretty far along. I'm going to ask Jerry to come up. He's been kind of leading that. Where is he? Did he step out? He's been leading the balanced scorecard effort, and not unlike, it's one of those things you've heard Jerry say many times, that we're building the plane in flight. So this is a work in progress, and we'll get better at it as we go along. But at this point, we're the strategic initiatives. There he is. Where have you been?
I could tell you, but I probably should.
Please
Make
don't.
A guess.
Please don't.
Well, you know, a lot of guesses.
John, well, do you want to repeat the question?
I asked the question, Jerry. How far along are we in the strategic planning framework in completing that? Is the board going to have any participation in that?
I expect the latter, yes. Building the airplane in flight is what I heard.
Yes.
That's my phrase. You don't stop anything in an organization to do this, so you heard Jennifer's timeline. But we are on a disciplined schedule. So where we are, we're just about to finish the DRCOG level, including measures, getting into our software system called Quick Score that is a balanced scorecard software for that can allow us to report back to you. MetroVision stuff will be factored in some way. That's the piece that's sort of unknown at this stage, and we'll see that. And now we're continuing, as my colleagues are here to know. I've ground them down a bit. But we're going through what's called cascading. Cascading is taking the organizational strategy map scorecard and working it through your organization for organizational alignment. So each division, AAA, CAM, TPO, RPO, and ANF, look at this strategy and say, how do we play in that sandbox? And we design a strategy for them to support the overall organizational strategy. Where we are now, we're very close to getting all objectives completed for all scorecards, and we have just completed ANF. Where's Roxy? Congratulations. We just completed ANF scorecard with the measures. So in the scorecard you have your objectives and measures primarily. So we're working through that, and we just have a little bit more to do. And Jennifer gave you a 4 or 5 month. We may actually be able to improve upon that and get it moving a little faster. Is that sufficient, or would you like more?
We can talk offline.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, this is our opportunity to ask for additional information on this from staff. So is there anybody else who has anything? Did I miss someone?
Ashley? Oh, you didn't?
No, she's blocking sun.
Oh, okay.
She's blocking the sun.
Sorry.
Can we put new shades in the... You know, they're not. It's not a strategic initiative? No. Okay, so... Pardon?
Not in the budget.
It's not in the budget. All right. Is there anyone else who would like to provide any additional direction, recommendations on anything else they'd like to see? Going once, going twice, Bob Pfeiffer and George Teal. All right. Hearing none, we're going to move on then to action agenda item number 10. Attachment C in your packet, discussion of a white paper on... advising future boards on kind of what we learned from the last TIP process. And Mr. Doug Rex, Transportation Planning and Operations Director.
Great. Thank you very much, Madam Chairman, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. We do, I think most in the room, we got a few new faces, and we'll talk about that here in a minute, but most will remember that we approved the 2016 to 2021 Transportation Improvement Program back in April of this year. It was certainly a highlight of staff to get that behind us, as I'm sure it was the board. But what we would like to do today is to really to initiate the discussion this evening of how, you know, we may be able to improve the process for future TIFs. And I won't be presumptuous to say that, you know, that we need to improve it, but I would suggest that maybe most have been through the process think there could be a few tweaks here and there. To get us to where we want to go. So, you know, your candor is very important tonight that we get some of these issues out on the table. And again, this is, you know, this is an initial meeting to talk about this. I would anticipate that there will be several more in trying to flush out all the details and reach consensus on some items. But so that's really kind of, you know, the purpose of the meeting tonight is really to kick this off and see if we can find some consensus on key issues so that we can inform future board of our findings in, so as they go forth and create their own process that that they're aware of some of the things that happened in the past TIP development. So, but again, like I said, I know there's some new faces around. So basically, real quick, just wanted to give you an overview of what the Transportation Improvement Program is. And it really is, I like to refer to it as kind of the DRCOG's Capital Improvement Program, right? It really is. It's a program of projects over the next 4 years. And although we refer to the TIP is a six-year document. We only program projects in the first 4 years. So there's reasons for that, particularly, you know, probably more so in the past than what we will going forward. CDOT does have a tendency to program projects out further in those last two years than what we have here at DRCOG. And it is by its very nature different than our regional transportation plan, which is a long-range planning vision document. The TIP is the short-range program. And it's updated every 4 years, which is the reason why we want to kick this off as early as possible so we can reach consensus on some issues and move forth with a new platform. So with regards to this map should look familiar to everyone. It's the DRCOG area. The bold blue line that you see throughout the map is what we call the TMA or the Transportation Management Area. It is basically, it's the MPO boundary. And for the sake of our discussion this evening, it is within that boundary that projects are eligible for the pots of money that we have access to. That being the SDP Metro money, Surface Transportation Program, Metro funds that we have sub-allocated directly to this region, Congestion Mitigation Air Quality Funds, or CMAQ funds, and Transportation Alternative Program funds, which primarily goes towards bicycle infrastructure and bike and pedestrian infrastructure. The only difference, the caveat to that, is that there are portions in the eastern end of the DRCOG area that is outside the TMA that are eligible for CMAQ money only. And the reason why is because that area, although it's outside the TMA, is within the air quality boundary. And those who most are familiar, we are in non-attainment for ozone, and so that area is eligible for CMAQ. So those who've been around for a while have seen this flow chart once or twice, and really what this is the allocation process that we went through for the development of the 2016 to 2021 TIP. The blue boxes indicate set-asides that were established before the call of projects were done. We have set-aside programs established, including the Way to Go, our DRCOG carpool program. We have our TDM program, Transportation Demand Management Program, and our stationary and urban center studies that have been longstanding within this agency and DRCOG that we participate in. And we also have these other commitments. The other commitments were primarily in this current TIP were fast tracks related, and we also there was an agreement to set aside some monies for the I-70 East project. So once that was done, we had approximately about $174-75 million, and then we select projects in two phases. The first phase is really based on the criteria which was established in our policy document, and we'll talk about that, I'm sure, at length tonight. So up to 75% is spent or is allocated to projects in first phase. In actuality, 71% ultimately was funded through the first phase process. And 29 and a little bit percent was funded in second phase. In second phase, the board has a little more discretion on how they want to allocate that funds. We use other variables, particularly this time. We had a series of maybe, seven, eight variables total. We had two primary ones, which were equity and very small communities, and there was other discussion such as first final mile and the like that was used in allocating the remaining monies that we had. So that is our process. I know the new folks are probably confused them more than not, but it was just but it was a refresher, I'm sure, for the rest of us. So the TIP itself, the process for the development of it was an 18-month process. 10 months of that involved the creation and the approval of the TIP policy document, which is really our guiding document for that has the criteria as well as the process and policies for the TIP document itself. Then we had the call for projects. It was an 8-week call. We review the applications, and you can see the rest. We select the first phase in late 2014, and then second phase in January 2015. So, today's discussion, and these are just topics, just guidelines for the discussion tonight. You know, these are some that, you know, really came to rise to the top as part of our discussion that we had with your technical staff, and I'll talk about that here in a minute as well. But some of the topics include, like, the TIP policy development and adoption. This is kind of the process, the TIP document that I was referring to, and the process that we use to create that document. And we've had we haven't had the same process for doing that through the years. This last time, MVIC took most of the control of that and most of the responsibilities for the creation. In the TIP prior to that, there was an ad hoc group that was established that was made up of elected officials from board members as well as technical staff that kind of drove that process. So, you know, it's been different through the years. Project eligibility. We have 8 project types, categories that are eligible in the current TIP that we just finished. You know, so maybe there's other types of projects you would like to have included in TIP, some maybe you would like to have removed. So that type of discussion. The evaluation criteria itself, you know, if you guys have all seen the criteria, maybe there's certain criteria that really doesn't have doesn't give you exactly what you want it to with regards to the selection of process. Maybe it's not as sensitive to, you know, to creating a differential between projects or whatever that that you might want to consider. And last but not least, the actual selection process, and we, as we refer to in the flow chart, that two-phase process that we go through in the selection of projects. All right, that's probably way too much talk for me. So really, we would like to get your comments tonight, and I appreciate your candor. We will, you know, we have video of this, so we'll have good documentation of the comments that are made. So we really do anticipate that, you know, there will be follow-up meetings to this, and not only with the board, is our anticipation that TAC and you know, our whole committee process will be involved in the creation and the discussion of this document. We did, in your packet, include the comment. We held a TIP open forum, which was held in June, and it was representatives of TAC were invited to that, as well as any other technical staff from communities that had submitted an application. So they had very good knowledge of the process, and we summarized those comments and provided that in your packet. We also included comments from Boulder and Arapaho County that we received prior to that TIP form that we wish to include. So with all that said, I think the next steps, I mean, and in regards to the action tonight, we really would like to get your direction on what the next steps would be. But ultimately, what we would like to do is create this white paper. And the motion itself, in reading it, is probably not exactly the way I wanted it to state. You know, best practices is mentioned in there, and it's probably not the best choice of words. I think primarily what it is, it's a white paper to reflect the consensus of key issues that through our committee process we think are the most important to inform future boards as they go forth and create the next TIP. So that's really what our hope is. And again, I'd be happy to answer any questions right now, or we just throw it open and get after it.
So I do expect that everyone who did participate in the TIP process probably does have some comments, so I am probably going to try and get to as many people as I can before I call on the same person over again. So I have a page full of comments myself, so I'll wait till the end, but hopefully somebody else I'll check them off as you guys say them. So I'm going to start with Commissioner Holland because I saw his hand go up, but before I start, can get a couple other hands so I see, okay, Mayor O'Brien. All right, we'll start.
Thank you, Jackie. Some of the suburban communities as well as counties have been concerned for some time about the disparity in the movement of the needle on transportation, and there's kind of a consensus that some of our voices are not being heard credibly, and addressed in favor of other policy issues which are impactful on other communities that define their needs a lot different than some of the suburban and suburban cities and counties. And what we would like, what Arapahoe County would like to see, and I think many of the other other counties as well as cities, is a more meaningful evaluative process by which an ad hoc committee could be appointed to include Dr. Cog staff and the TACT, which would more effectively work to address these disparities and provide a more equitable and process of selection. That the criteria, in some cases, the criteria doesn't adequately address the condition of our roadways in that evaluation, whereby we found in repairing roadways that are in desperate need of repair, one method is a cheap, I think inefficient method by just, you know, putting chip rock or whatever over the top of it rather than addressing the long-term need of that area, whereby major major reconstruction of those roadways are necessary to extend the life. Those are factors that are considered. I think that this white paper should have the participation of this committee, however it's selected, so that we can come together with these divergent views of the funding process and allow us to work out on a friendly and factual level how that criteria should be developed. And I think most of us will agree that it's better than talk than to complain after the process is completed. And that's what our goal is. Thank you.
Mayor O'Brien.
You may have already considered this, but if you haven't, I'd like to get our foot in the door. And that is perhaps as we go through this process to spend more time, especially with the smaller communities like ours that may not have the expertise at the staff level to really understand, you know, when you first start looking at this, it's Greek to a lot of people, becomes Latin after a certain amount of point, and eventually English. But I think we're at that point, and I must say, Dr. Cog's staff has been extremely welcoming and open to meetings. I would even extend that to training programs, seminars, and community visits that would be really worthwhile. It's one thing that I understand and the board understands, our board of trustees understands more about transportation, but it's really critical that town staff understand, you know, the inner workings, because ultimately all plans have to degenerate into work. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Councilmember Teal.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. One thing we would like to see introduced as a topic of discussion is factoring in growth. I mean, obviously the region is growing, but there are probably separate jurisdictions within the region that are growing at different speeds. For those of our communities like Castle Rock that are growing fast, we're finding ourselves in a catch-22 with some of our major infrastructure, just in that we can make growth pay for itself for a lot of the regular stuff, paving roads, utilities, but when it comes to major structures to get on and off I-25, eventually we'll probably get to a mass transit discussion as we grow larger. You suddenly kick it up a notch, and regional help through the TIP would be very welcome. And I can't believe that Castle Rock's the only jurisdiction in that same spot.
And Councilmember Till got to one of the issues that I was going to suggest might be helpful for a future board is to look at the world that exists then and look at the environment that exists, not just at the regional level, but at the state and the federal level. Look at the funding that we have, the priorities that we have. Have we just made a tremendous investment in fast tracks? Is BRT something we want to expand? I think the future board might want to ask, and growth is certainly something that is growth a huge issue. In my mind, we should take a more strategic look at the TIP and not just have eight categories of projects, but actually, if I was here, and I won't be, when the next TIP process comes along, that I would want the board to...
That's a promise, right?
It's a factor of term limits, but maybe I'll make an exception. But my comment would be, this body should take a step back and a high-level strategic look at the transportation environment and decide what the priorities should be for the region, that we shouldn't just be giving money away, not giving money away. We should not be selecting projects based on a category type. We should be doing it based on need, and I certainly think growth is one of the issues that I would expect to be coming in. Mayor Pro Tem Vigil.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I happen to agree with the commissioner from Arapahoe County, and that is that if you recall a conversation we had, and I can't remember, I think it was last month, that we couldn't figure out what multimodal means. And we take a look at this TIP process and all the items that we have listed in here, we'll never get anywhere with it. So we definitely need an ad hoc committee, a smaller group, to take a look at it. And not only take a look at some of the items that we have listed in here, but also to take a look at some other areas and see how they're doing it, and just take a look and see are there any similarities or not. I mean, we just don't have to just stay within our area itself. Obviously, there's other COGs out there that are having the same problem. Oh, they have to go through the same process anyway, at least. And how do they do it? You know, I think somebody mentioned, I can't remember what meeting it was, I said, you know, I think it was Gabe probably, I can't remember who it was that said, you know, I don't mind stealing ideas from other people if they work, okay?
But he stole that from Phil.
He stole that from Phil, okay.
But
it was Phil.
From me.
All right, okay, yes. And so definitely I think that's a proper way to go about it, and including staff and from Dr. Cog and maybe some people from the board and some from the staff of TAC. Obviously they're very, very beneficial to us on that process. So I do support that particular idea.
Eva, wait, I'm sorry, I have Phil Cernanek first and then.
Doug, you've heard me mention this before. One is that it starts out and it's going to be explainable and understandable. This gets to Mayor O'Brien's piece in the end, because unless it's explainable and understandable, it's impossible to be perceived by all as fair. If there's some black box components, it may be complicated, but if you're able to explain it, and that's going to be important. I would like several other things to be at least considered as this group goes about in setting out some principles, and some of these are things that we've talked about. Dollar exchanges with CDOT for possibility of dollars that are less encumbered gives us some benefit. I believe we need to be in some position of understanding what is locally responsible versus what is regionally responsible, and having some ideas as to how that's going to occur. How are things actually going to be shared in this? We went through quite a bit of a discussion in MVIC, and I'll echo Mayor Pro Tem Vigil's comments about ensuring there's an actual scanning of practices that are out there, as well as some innovative thought as to what Map 21 is going to do for us eventually. And when I say for us, it could be to us in that. but being in a position of understanding what measures should be included and how that accountability, that we're going to be dealing with that on a regional basis, because if we don't take a look at that, and whether this gets us to the point of actually having system-wide principles, we have some that are done in a way that is organized and understood. And from the ad hoc group, I think it should include some folks on a technical side. It should include folks from staff. And whether or not there might be a few others that get involved in that, I would leave that open.
The executive director would like to actually ask you a follow-up question. So,
can you imagine? I just wanted to be clear. When you said, Phil, how the dollars would be shared, and then you talked about scanning the practices of others, so those were two interrelated things. Okay, just wanted to be sure.
You know, we varied some of our approach so that our analysis was just done on what was being asked from the regional pool, and so it gets into that aspect of sharing and making sure we don't destroy something that we may have made some progress on, or at least in a position. And so I'll state it more specifically: how the system doesn't get gamed.
Commissioner Henry.
I think this is a perfect opportunity to start thinking outside the box and possibly recreating the process. We've been doing the same process since 1992, and I think after a few decades, it really is time. The region has changed. It really is time to actually take a look at the process, and I support Mayor Pro Tem Vigil's not quite a motion, but his idea of the fact that we need an ad hoc group of TAC members and staff members, because we got plenty of time now to take a look at other organizations to see what they're doing and how they're doing it. And possibly there might be a better fit for, you know, for us than what we went through this last couple of processes. And so I would really encourage this group to, it's time to shake it up, and it's time to start looking out the outside the box, and it's time to reinvent on how this process is actually done.
And I absolutely agree, and I think that kind of is the intention, and this is kind of the kickoff. Staff originally went to TAC and said, you know, we heard a lot of comments, and the board is very anxious to maybe do a debrief on the TIP, and what are your thoughts? I think, and they said, well, have the board tell us what they didn't like about the last process or improvements that they would like to see. And I think the process is expected to go back then to TAC. It is an iterative process. I think the point of tonight is to actually find out, solicit input from board members about specific things that really drove them crazy in the last process. And everything that we present is going to be go back to TAC. And that doesn't mean we're not creating an ad hoc. That's on my list of a TIP work group. But I would also like to encourage this group to kind of come up with, individually, I know some of you complained about this process specifically to me, and ways to improve it. And so I would love the group to hear some of those comments and kind of maybe it'll spark some ideas with somebody else that had said, oh, yeah, I didn't like the way that congestion scoring was handled either. That didn't make sense to me. Is that, could we be doing that better? Why don't we have a category on first last mile connections? Why wasn't that prioritized in the phase one and versus phase two? Why are we allowing three different funding scenarios to be submitted for a project? So a project will be submitted as 20% funded, 30% funded, and 40% funded. If a community can fund it with a 40% match, let them do it that way. I mean, these are picky little things, but I guess this is the ideas that we're hoping, in addition to the great suggestion to get it back to TAC and have a work group, and completely agree that we do want to shake the process up. So what other things didn't this body like about the last process? Elise.
Well, so I think this group does its best work when we can all put on our regional hats and think collaboratively. And I think the TIP process ends up taking us to the other end of the spectrum, whereas understandably so. We are as parochial as we can get because we're fighting for dollars for our particular projects in our community. So to me, one of the frustrating things about the process is how do we elicit the regional thinking and collaboration as much of it as we can before we start dispersing dollars. To me, that would be to start out big picture. What's our regional vision? Let's take it down to our, you know, 20-year plan, our RTP, and then get to the tip. And the process we followed was the exact opposite. We started at the microcosm of where we're going to give money, and then we build our 20-year plan, and then now we're looking at our vision. So to me, the timing, we need to get the timing right and start at the big common ground and then work our way down to tip disbursement. And I agree with what you said about trying to be strategic. Obviously, at some level, every jurisdiction needs some money for transportation, and I get that. But I think that a majority of the funds should go to projects that are regionally significant or regionally meaningful in terms of building out the transportation system. So we get the biggest bang for every transportation dollar. So that means, again, thinking regionally and collaboratively ahead of time about what those criteria are before we're thinking about what project we're trying to fund as a jurisdiction. So again, trying to determine the criteria way ahead of time before we start thinking about, gee, well, how will that affect the money that might flow to my jurisdiction? So, and that could be things like first and final mile and other things. But again, if we don't start out big picture, we don't know how to set those criteria.
Robin. Thanks. I am great with the idea of an ad hoc committee, but I just worry a little bit about being clear on what the ask is for them so that we don't leave this table and then staff has to come back, as they sometimes do, and say, what did you mean? So, for example, I mean, I don't think an ad hoc committee that's meeting now can really decide a set of rules and processes for a body that will change significantly and a region that will change significantly within the next 3 years. So we need to figure out what level that ad hoc committee is working at. So it sounds to me like the idea is the ad hoc committee writes the white paper, kind of more so than the ad hoc committee writes the next tip. But we should clarify that from those who raised it. In terms of, you know, my own suggestion, I agree a lot with Val and others about the best practice thing. And I actually appreciated staff was responsive to that request and brought in a few things. But I think they were late. And so it was hard. So I would actually say that that is a good role for the ad hoc committee. For example, one thing that I think, an idea that was really intriguing to me was, I forget if it was a Seattle or Portland region, somewhere in the West, where they did a major pool, the majority of the funds or a significant chunk of the funds was scored and done regionally, but then they did sub areas of the region where some decision making became more local. And presumably not, it still has to meet criteria, but it's more of a pass-fail criteria. You know, it's not necessarily that you get to fund anything. It's not a popularity contest. You still have to be responsive to the regional goals. But that, to me, was a thing that we looked at too late. And so that would be the kind of thing that I think might be outside the box and help to break up some of the, I mean, it is hard for 56 people to agree on priorities. And so if you can create some tiers where that decision making becomes a little more localized but is still regional, I think that would be really great to explore. And I think that might help with some of the concerns about small communities and things that we've tried to do in kind of awkward ways, which is like score people but then skip over certain scores. That's awkward, right? So I think if there's other ways we can get to those concerns, it will probably be better for the body.
George, and then Shakti.
So I think Robin was reading my notes. So I'd like to put a little sharper point on what Robin was saying there, because I, having mostly been a very a new guy and an ignorant observer of what was going on during the TIP process as we ended it, one of the things that struck me was we didn't account for the priority with the submitting jurisdiction. And so very much like Robin was saying, you know, when we had some projects that for that jurisdiction that submitted it, this was their top priority. But that was not necessarily taken into account when figuring the TIP score, when or in the second phase. And yet, having been a beneficiary of the second phase, I can tell you the one of the projects that was awarded, Castle Rock, that we kind of did a little bit of horse trading about, guys, that was our top priority. Oh, yeah, sorry, Eva. That was our top priority in the town. And so when it came time to play Let's Make a Deal, we were willing to take that lesser cut because it was our top priority. As opposed to, and please, I do not mean to point any fingers with this, but where a couple times the comment was made, if we don't get this, then we can't complete the project. Whereas if it's the top priority for the submitting, or the highest priority projects for the jurisdiction submitting those, they're probably going to find a way to fund it anyhow, and it will have that regional impact that Elise was speaking to as well. I don't know how we do that. I don't know how we keep it from being a black box kind of thing like Phil talked about and being something that, you know, communities are fudging. But if there's a way that we could try to integrate that in, I think that could have a lot of benefit for a broad range of our communities.
Shakti.
I'll go from big comments to little comments.
Yeah, is your mic on?
The light's on.
Just put it, you and I have the opposite problem. I speak loudly into mine.
I'll go from big comments to little comments. So I very much agree with the comments about getting bang for our buck. What is the regional impact? And I almost wonder if just starting the process with like a conversation about what transportation projects do you think would have the biggest effect on the region, or what do you, like a brainstorming session might be sort of a good general big picture way to start. Then if we stay with something like the current system, I think we could revisit whether the breakdown of phase one and phase two money is appropriate. I'm a little more comfortable with the regimented approach of phase one, but then there was an issue of rolling down the money. There's an unfunded project. My memory is that there's not enough funds to fund a project, so then does it go to the next project, and how many projects down do you go before it goes into the phase two pot? And it seemed to me that the rule could be that it goes down a little bit farther, and so I don't know if maybe it goes down three projects, or maybe it goes down until, and this is a little more logical, I think, until there's a certain score that, so that you want to be funding only good projects, but so. And then I wondered if in phase two, projects that are not considered in phase one, like studies, should get some sort of special treatment. And then I read TAC's comments, and without really knowing all the nuances, there's one comment about whether funding rebuilding of roads incentivizes not maintaining the roads, and I thought that was an interesting comment. And we also had a category that we had significantly under-applied, not enough applicants, and I think that that needs to be revisited. Just why did that happen?
Suzanne.
I agree with a lot of what's been said in terms of the focus on the beginning with focusing on the high level strategic, what's regionally significant. I like what people are saying about, for gosh sakes, let's learn from other regions and steal their best ideas. I think that's fine. I think TAC provided a lot of useful feedback when I read through that list. There's some basic technical things we should improve, whether it's making sure the mapping capability works, and making sure everything's defined and the criteria are clear, so when people are making applications that they understand how they'll be scored. Like, some of that's just basic
process.
Good process. I mean, so yes, let's do that stuff. I guess the other piece, though, is I would add is there's some established good planning criteria out there that professionals use that we should kind of ground ourselves. We know that eventually some of this gets political, but let's try to stay as clear about what is the state-of-the-art thinking in terms of good, solid regional transportation planning. What really does work? Not what do we think work, what people thought worked 20 years ago, but what do the big minds think we should be doing to get ahead of things? So I guess I would like to be grounded in the data and the latest thinking, and that partly comes from let's look around and see what regions seem to be capturing that. I know, you know, in the end, it's, when we divide up monies, it does become a little bit parochial, but I, to the extent that we can really ground the big spending and the big thinking and the process in these regionally things that benefit the region in a way that then filters down to everyone's jurisdictions, I think is a good way to go. I think I'm fine with an ad hoc committee writing the white paper. I agree that nobody's going to tell a body 3 years from now what they're going to do now. So, I think more to capture the lessons and give direction is helpful. And I do think we should keep taking it back to TAC, because I think in the end, those guys that do it day in and day out have a lot of really good insights.
Roger.
Madam Chair, I have to say, this is probably one of the most relaxed meetings we've had in a long time, so I commend you. I think it's wonderful to hear the comments. Certainly, I agree with everything that's been said. I think it's wonderful to hear, and I think we're hearing a lot of good things. I hope staff is hearing a lot of good things. I also believe the staff report from TAC brought forward, I believe, a lot of the considerations. And also on that TAC, being it's a professionals, as I call, and I think all of us refer to, as our individuals on the TAC as our subject matter experts. And with the combination of the subject matter experts with staff and the TAC, I think that's a great combination. So with that, I'm going to attempt to give a motion. This is a very long motion, I'll warn you, this is a very complicated process, and as Commissioner Jones mentioned, you know, somewhere down the line, so I'm going to throw a time frame in there too. So I'll read it again if it's not her, but I'm going to read it out now. So I move in the process to create a white paper, direct Dr. Cog staff to arrange for an ad hoc committee of a combination of Dr. Cog staff and any interested TAC members to address TIP scoring, the funding allocation, and any other criteria referenced by this board, including looking at other MPOs around the country, and to bring this back to the board in 6 months, which I looked at approximately be the 2017-16 meeting.
May I make one friendly amendment to your motion? Instead of saying TIP scoring, could we expand it to be TIP process? Because I think we wanted to potentially examine other best practices and processes. Is
very
that
good.
Does that work?
Change the word TIP scoring to TIP process. I agree.
And I second it.
Okay. Any discussion on this motion? Yes.
Who's on the ad hoc committee? Again, I just...
Combination of Dr. Cog staff and any interested TAC members.
TAC members. Got it.
Yes.
Wow, it might actually happen. Well, it'll come back to us. We'll get a bite at the apple. We'll get it. Yeah, exactly. Define wordsmithing. All right, we have a motion and a second. Is there any other comment on the motion? Does anyone have a question, and everyone understands the motion? Great. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained. Motion passes. Okay, is there any other comment or direction? Because I actually have another two, I would say, smaller level issues that arose that were brought to my attention from the last TIP process. So does anybody else have any of those? Rita?
I'm new to this process, but what I found was that, and it was mentioned in one of these documents here about categories where projects didn't fit, and also one that they suggested was like bridges. It seems to me that you should have a way to fall back on, or fail-safe, basically, to go back to the objectives of Dr. Cog, you know, the vision and objectives. So if you can't find a specific category to put it into, maybe you need to go back and look at what is the overall, like we're talking about regional transportation, you know, you need to go back to what are we about here and what are our objectives here, rather than just trying to find a specific category that's defined too narrowly for the project. Thank you.
Mr. Dyack.
I think it's anticlimactic now.
That, I know it is, but go ahead.
But I mean, to me, the I'll just try and be brief. I agree with Mayor Lyons, who's not here yet, that Dr.
When you talk, he leaves. Did you notice that?
Yeah, everyone does leave when I talk about him. I do believe Dr. Cog should provide assistance to small communities or to the board as a whole if they have the subject matter experts. So, I mean, to me, if it's a part of this or any other person, I would hope that Dr. Cog can be very consultative if a municipality has a need. I just wrote a few words down that I wanted out of this alignment and unification. If there's a way for this process, and you know, I think it's more of after we get to this white paper, but it seems like we're all competing against each other, and we as a region should be aligned. There's an awful lot of effort that we've put to try and define criteria where we can potentially get funding dollars, and if there's a way we could sort of sidestep that competition and create alignment and streamline this process, I think that'd be a great thing, because I don't want to compete against a project in somebody else's backyard. I think they're all important. I think we all have enough trust and respect for each other that if we get the dollars, even at a local level, if the local control can happen like George was indicating, I think we would have the wherewithal to put the dollars to best use as we see fit. So to me, it's about trust, respect, local control, streamlined approach, transparent process, and we'd save an awful lot of time.
Okay, are there any other, because I've got some really low-level ones that were raised to me, but I think are valuable that this ad hoc group could look at, is also, should there be a minimum dollar amount for a project, depending on the size of the community, and maybe we would exempt small communities, but should there be a minimum dollar amount? Because these dollars are federalized and it costs more. The other question was that communities are limited by the number of projects that they are allowed to submit, and that's been that way for a long time. And let's take a look at that and find out if those numbers still make sense today. I mean, we've been doing the same thing since 1992. So, should some communities now be able to apply for some more projects? Should there be limits? What should the limits for the community be? And then the other ones that were brought up were a process issue. You know, we did have a scoring mistake that was found during the last TIP process. Is there a way that we can improve that process and provide better double-checking verification on the scoring sooner in the process? I think we didn't find out about that mistake till projects were ranked and people kind of thought they were getting money and didn't get money, and that creates problems. And then God help them for trying, but really, you know, what this idea of equity and you know, equity was a huge discussion topic by this body. And what does that mean? And is it spreading peanut butter around, or is it actually really trying to solve large regional problems, creating this regional pot? And then I think this idea of having a large regional pot and then giving some monies back to, whether it's by county or community, to allow local decision-making to occur, which I've heard repeatedly from another people at this table, sounds like that idea has a lot of merit. So the ad hoc group could pay particular attention to that. So I think those were the only other things I had written down from comments I had received. Is it? And I'm looking at Mayor Cernanek, and I think he's got a comment.
Yes, Doug. I just wanted to make sure you had special note of mixing peanut butter and asphalt.
And horses at some point, but okay. All right, I think we have provided direction to staff. If there's not any additional comments regarding this agenda item, I would suggest we move on. Okay, let's go. To the committee reports, the informational briefings. And actually, before I do that, I was not aware that we also have another new alternate that is here tonight from Columbine Valley. And Mayor Gail Christie, would you please introduce your new alternate that's here?
Yes, I'd like to introduce Richard Champion in the back row. Richard. He's our new alternate. Richard served in DRCOG in 1990 to 94, so he has
God bless you.
Some previous experience, and he'll be my my alternate.
Thank you. Thank you for coming tonight, and we'll give you a round of applause. Thank you for being here. And Mayor, I apologize. I didn't see your hand earlier tonight. So, okay, now we're going to move on to the informational briefings. Agenda item number 11, and I'm going to request that they be brief and reflect decisions made and information germane to the business of DRCOG. Commissioner Jones on the stack.
Stack had no action items, just informational reports on federal legislation, Bustang, I-70 East, and the National Disaster Resilience Competition. If you want to know anything more about it, talk to Doug.
Okay. Okay, and Mayor Horn is not here from the Metro Mayor's Caucus. Is there anything, Mayor Rakowski, since you're the first mayor I looked at and I haven't heard from you tonight? No. Okay. All right.
I would add.
Of course you would. That's why I didn't ask you.
I'm going to add one item because the Metro Mayors did have a press conference, but announced a pool of money that's been gathered as a landlord incentive for homeless. And since that sometimes comes up, that the Metro Mayor's Caucus, in conjunction with both the Rental Association and other facilities, have put together a program for landlord incentives.
Thank you, Mayor. Okay, moving on to the Metro Area County Commissioners. Commissioner Rozier.
No report, Madam
okay.
Chair.
Okay. Advisory Committee on Aging, Jayla.
We did not have a meeting in July, so no report.
Thank you. And then as far as RAC, we are actually meeting next week, so there is no report from the RAC. Mayor Rakowski, see, now I'm calling on you again. E-470, sir.
Three very quick items. We keep setting records in terms of usage, and I'm sad to report that one of our best board members, Jim Benson, has announced that he'll be leaving the board later this year, and that is a loss for the board. And lastly, the executive director, John McCuskey, has announced his retirement at the end of the year. So a lot of changes coming.
Thank you, Mayor. Fast Tracks, Mr. Van Meter.
Thank you. As I reported last month, the Fast Tracks Monitoring Committee of the Board had approved the Southeast Rail Extension Contract Award, or actually recommended it for approval to the full board at that point. At their July 28th board meeting, the Board of Directors did approve award of the contract to BBRI, Balfour Beatty Rail, for the Southeast Rail Extension Design-Build Contract on a 13-2 vote. So that moved forward last month, and in August the RTD board, at both their monitoring committee as well as in an action last night, approved the annual program evaluation for Fast Tracks, which is the long-term financial plan for Fast Tracks and a precursor to setting the budget for Fast Tracks for next year. Those are the only items I have to report.
Thank you. Okay, we are concluded. The informational items are in your packets, attachment D, E, and F. Actually, there's good information there. I would ask you to review that at your leisure. The next meeting is September 16th. Are there any other matters by members? Elise.
Just really briefly, I think all of us might have come to the realization that we really know our jurisdiction really well, but don't really have a very clear understanding of how the world looks from other jurisdictions. And several of us on the board have been taking advantage of each other in terms of asking for tours and visits to other jurisdictions. And I think credit goes to Mayor Rakowski, who started this by inviting me to Greenwood Village for a several-hour tour. And that inspired me then to reach out to Roger Partridge and trade tours. I spent several hours down in Douglas County, and then Roger came up to Boulder County. And then I also went out to Bennett to sit with Sue Horn and her city manager. And John Diet came to Boulder, city of Boulder, and had a beer with me, and we talked shop. Mm-hmm. So it seems to be this groundswell of information sharing. But I won't go into the gory details of all that I learned.
John.
but I will say it was particularly interesting going down to Douglas County and realizing how alike Boulder County and Douglas County are in terms of our philosophy about concentrating growth in existing urban areas and protecting open space. I got to eat lunch at the Cherokee Ranch Castle and look over the views and. You know, very similar experience that you can have in Boulder County. And so it was really eye-opening for me, and I really appreciate Roger taking the time to do that. And I encourage other people to consider similar outings, and I hope to make it around to the rest of the board, but that'll take some time. And Roger, did you want to?
Sure. Echo those words with Elise, and I agree with Elise. Our communities are so much alike. I think we kind of looked at each other in shock when that was said, and you're going, you're right. You know, we've got 89% of our population on 18% of our land. It's wonderful, and I don't think Boulder County is any different. And the other opportunity we had is to visit all these small communities and large communities that are each other's counties. So it was very fascinating. Mayor Rakowski, certainly appreciate the tour, too. But it certainly gives you a perspective, no doubt. You get a feel of traffic. You get a feel of the people. And you think how wonderful, how blessed we are to be Colorado. Not only do we
Denver region.
Yeah, the whole Denver region really is, because you look how many number ones are the top 10, we see that. But that's because not only all of us, but it's all the people that live here that we represent. I think we're just so fortunate that the conversations we have, even though we have some contention, we're ahead of the pack in a lot of ways. That's the time to have contention and have good discussion.
Thank you guys for sharing your experience. I think that's great. And with
and let the record show that I actually was in Castle Rock.
we're gonna end on a happy note. So, with that, yeah, there was a brewery. With that, we're adjourned. See you in September.